Chanti Deva Sunvantam Naswapnaya Sprayanti. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon to you. I am extremely sorry that I am not able to come to the university campus because of my ill health. But because of all this, I am the loser, because I will not be able to have a personal contact with you, a discussion after the lecture, which would have been very profitable to me. Anyway, I am grateful to General Bakshi, who has very kindly arranged for a TV team to come here and record my talk. But it would be a monologue sort of thing, only one-sided, nothing from you as a reaction. Well, we are having a seminar on the Saraswati, various aspects of it. There are geological aspects, there are geological aspects, literary aspects, and archaeological aspects. I propose talking to you on the archaeological aspects. Deal with, first of all, with the theory of Aryan invasion of India, which has gained ground and which does not seem to leave us. There are scholars in the West who have been propagating it and still continue to do it. And there are a few followers in India as well. And now the roots of this conception that there was an Aryan invasion go back to the 19th century, when Max Mueller, the German scholar, dated the Vedas to 1200 B.C. His was a very simplistic method. He accepted that the sutras were datable to 600 B.C. Now, before the sutra literature, there were three earlier stages, namely those of the Aranyakas, Brahmanas, and finally the Vedas. He gave 200 years to each of these stages. So 600 plus 200 plus 200 plus 200. He arrived at the figure of 1200 BC. When his contemporary scholars in Europe expressed their dislike of this kind of methodology, which is ad hoc, we said, why not 500 years for each, which would make it to 2000 BC, or why not just 100 years? So a confused Max Mueller finally would do it, and he said in his book, Physical Religion, that whether the Vedas were 1000 year old, or 1500 year old, or 2000 year old, or 3000 year old, nobody on earth will ever be able to determine it. And this is a complete surrender by him. But the whole pity is that in spite of Max Mueller's surrender, there are people in Europe and America and some in India who continue to harp on this figure of 1200 BC. They dare not cross this lakshmana rekha. Now the effect of this dating of the Vedas to 1200 BC was very disastrous. So when 1920s, the Harappan civilization was discovered, it became an easy conclusion for most of the people that since the Vedas are not older than 1200 BC, and since this civilization is datable to 3rd millennium BC on the basis of its contact with West Asian cultures, this cannot be of the Vedic people, because 1200 is much later than third millennium B.C. So the proposal was that if these are not Vedic people, they must be the Dravidian speaking people. I'll come to that point a little later, but I'll go into a little bit more of history of these discoveries. In 1946, Sir Mortimer Wheeler discovered a fortification around one of the mounds at Harappa. Somebody told him, he didn't know much of Sanskrit, rather no Sanskrit at all, but somebody told him that in the Vedas, Indra is mentioned as Purandar, destroyer of the forts. So he jumped at once to the conclusion. I was working with him at Harappa. He jumped to the conclusion, here is my fort, and here is Purandar destroying the fort. In other words, he said that the Aryans destroyed the Harappan civilization and drove away the Dravidian speaking Harappans to South India. Now, this was a very naive sort of. You see, first of all, the theory of invasion that he developed on the basis of the fort at Harappa, the word Purandar, and added to it the skeleton remains at Mohenjo-daro. About 30 skeletons have been found at that site. So he said, here are the people who were massacred. Now he, I knew him personally. He was a very great technician in digging, unparalleled at that time anywhere. But jumping to conclusions was his great weakness. So he said that these skeletal remains are the ones which represent the massacre by the invading Aryans. But there is a very great fallacy in this thesis. These skeletons do not come from one single level. They come from different strata of the site, which means they belong to different periods. And some of these skeletons were found outside the mound. So how can these be related to one single event, namely invasion, and much less that of the Aryans? So the Aryan invasion thesis really is thoroughly baseless. In fact, an American scholar, a specialist on human bones, an anthropologist, he showed by making a thorough study of these skeletons of ancient times, he says there is no evidence whatsoever of new people coming between 2600 BC and 800 BC. So there is no evidence whatsoever about a new set of people. So the Aryan invasion theory actually has no basis. Now coming to the equation between the Harappan civilization and the Dravidian speaking people, Wheeler's theory was that when the Aryans invaded, they drove away the Harappans to South India. Now it is easy to say that, it's easy to imagine that, but there is no proof for that. In the entire region of South India, whether it is Tamil Nadu or Andhra Pradesh or Karnataka or Kerala, at no place do we find a single remain, a single site which is of Harappan affiliation. So how can that be? That doesn't work. There is another way of looking at the whole thing. If some outsiders come and occupy a place, the names of the rivers, mountains and others of the earlier people, some of them continue, although the new people will give new names to them. Say, for example, in America, while New Jersey or New York are new names given by the Europeans, the old names continue in the form of rivers. Both Mississippi and Missouri rivers are non-European names belonging to the earlier people. Like Massachusetts and Chicago also are non-European names. But there is no such situation in the entire area occupied by the Harappan civilization. So, there is nothing to suggest that the Dravidian-speaking people were living in the Harappan area. Now, we have discussed two things up till now. One is that there was no Aryan nation. The other is that the Harappans were not Dravidian-speaking people. But things don't end there. There are scholars who hold, or rather you can say, the invasion theory comes in a new avatar, and that is of immigration. If there was no invasion, the Aryans immigrated into India from Central Asia. I'll quote two scholars. Romila Thapur, Arya Sharma. So both together produce two theses. One is that the Bactria Margana people were nomads, and it is these nomads who came to India and established the Vedic culture. Now both these aspects are absolutely wrong. As you would see from the map that I'm presenting to you, is that the Bactria Margana complex is east of the Caspian Sea in Central Asia. Most of it is covered by Tajikistan and northern Afghanistan. So the thesis is that it is from this region that these Bactria Margana archaeological complex people came to India. Now there contention is that they were nomads, which is absolutely wrong. I'll show you a few photographs of sites as well as of antiquities, which clearly show that the Bactria Margana archaeological complex is a highly developed urban civilization. Here is a temple at Togluk in Margana. You can see on the screen that it has three successive fortifications, not one but three, one after the other, and each one had towers around them. Then the next public building is a citadel at Gunur. It again is a very big complex with fortifications and rectangular towers. Within it, there are places for administrative office, for secretariat, for others, and including an area earmarked for burials. Then on it there is this royal insignia, a tiger and eagle. And in the hole, a shaft used to be put with, made of silver. And this was an axe used evidently for a royalty. Then another item that I would like to show you is a figure of a feline, probably a tiger. Now it is made of chlorite stone and has golden covering on it. And within the golden covering, there are precious stones studded. Now, would you call these creations of nomads? Nomads are people who wander from place to place. They don't have any place to stay. They are not, pastorals even. So, I am sorry to say that both Professor Thapar and Sharma did not do their homework. They were in a hurry because, as Rumila Sapar said, that if invasion doesn't work, immigration would do. So, without thoroughly studying the BMAC culture, they made this claim. And the most important part is that none of the elements of the Bactria margina archaeological complex ever entered India. Now, I'll show you a map. I have a few more maps, but I'll confine only to one, in which you can see the typical Bactria margina complex antiquities, seals, ceilings, and other things. They do go to the west up to Turkey, and in the east, they are there's a cutoff line in red. I have shown it. None of the things ever entered east of the Indus. That was the area where the Vedic people were living, Punjab and all that. So, this theory again fails. The Vedic Aryans were not invaders. If they were not immigrants, then the question arises, were they indigenous? And the answer is yes. But before you accept the answer, I'd like to tell you how it works. And it's very interesting how geology, how hydrology, and such other sciences help us to resolve this issue. As I said at the beginning, it is the wrong dating of the Vedas to 1200 BC, which is the root cause of this trouble. And it is very surprising and interesting that the life history of the Saraswati River plays a very important role in determining the date of the Vedas. It's an unusual method of determining the date of the Vedas, but I have done it and I'll tell you how it works. In the Rig Veda, the Saraswati is mentioned at least 70 times. It is Ambitabe, that is the best of the mothers, Naditame, the best of the rivers, Devitame, the best of the goddesses. All sorts of praises are showered on the Saraswati. And it is said that it Giribhyo Asamudrat, from the mountains to the sea, it was flowing, a mighty flowing river. Now, while we were excavating at Kalibangan in Rajasthan, a site which is situated on the bank of the river Saraswati, which is now dry, we are keen on finding out when and how the river dried. We did borings in the river board, and hydrologists were at work, and an Italian team also helped us in that. We discovered that the city of Kalibangan had to be abandoned because of the drying up of the river. No water supply. How can a city continue? And when did it happen? C14 did show that around 2000 BC, the Saraswati dried up. How it dried up is another matter. Or very briefly, you see the channel through which the Saraswati was coming to the plains. In that channel, a Bhatamarkanda divide came. It was an earth movement which threw up a 30-meter high barrier in the course of the river. And the river had to couldn't follow the ancient course, and it got back. And through Yamuna Terrace, it came to the Yamuna Ganga basin, which was overflowed, which has other repercussions. But anyway, for our present purpose, the Saraswati dried up around 2000 BC. Now, what are the repercussions? It was a mighty flowing river during the Vedic times, right? In 2000, it dried up. Which means what? Which means that the Vedas are pre-2000 BC, because the river dried up in 2000 BC. So, Rig Veda must be dated to a period before 2000 BC. A third millennium BC, is the minimum estimate that can be made. Now comes another very important point. In the Rig Veda, 10th mandal, 75th sukta, there are two shlokas which are very, very important. You see, strangely, as if these Vedic people were writing out a book on geography, they mention the rivers, Ime, Gange, Yamune, Saraswati, Shatatri, and so on, up to the Sindhu, Indus River. This is the area that the Vedic people were occupying from Ganga, upper reaches of Ganga, Yamuna on the east, to the Indus. Now, in the 3rd millennium BC, the time of the Rig Veda. What is the archaeological culture that was there in this very period, in the 3rd millennium BC, in this space? It is nothing except the Harappan culture. We call it by different names. It is known as Indus civilization, Harappan civilization, Indus Saraswati civilization, and even Saraswati civilization now. So this very culture was there in the 3rd millennium BC, which was the time when the Rig Vedic people were occupying there. And I have a map to show to you. And this map clearly shows, you see, in red outline, you have the Rig Vedic area, and black dotted lines, we have the Harappan civilization. They are overlapping, it's exactly the same area of the Rig Vedic people and of the Harappan civilization. In other words, the Harappan civilization and the Rig Veda are two facets of the same coin. The literary facet is the Rig Veda. The material culture facet is the Harappan civilization. So the Harappan and the Rig Veda people were the authors of the Harappan civilization. Well, against this correlation, that is the Harappan and Vedic equation, three objections have been raised. One is that the Harappan civilization is hybridized, highly Aryanized. But according to these people, they say that the Vedic people were nomads. Then there is another objection that whereas there was a horse in the Harappan, in the Vedic culture, there was no horse in the Harappan. Another point that they raise is that where is the wheels of chariots in the Vedas were spoked. The Harappan wheels did not have any spoke. All these three objections are meaningless. To call the Vedic people nomads is absolutely wrong. Even if for the time being we forget the equation between Harappan civilization and Rig Veda. In the Rig Veda itself, there is plenty of evidence which shows that the Vedic people were highly advanced, Aryanized people. They were not nomads going from place to place. Now in Rig Veda 10th mandal, it is mentioned, there is a prayer, "Stitch ye, O gods, coats of armor, wide and many, make metal forts secure from all assailants. Then another verse it is mentioned, "And irresistible be thou a mighty metal fort to us with 100 walls for man's defense." Now the forts may not have been made of metal, but they were strong enough like metal. So they lived in cities which were fortified. And we find the Harappan civilization are all fortified. On the economic front too, the Vedic people were highly advanced. Trade was carried on sea. I mean, land trade was already there, but on sea. And a verse says, O soul, pour thou forth four seas filled with thousandfold riches. I mean, they were having trade via sea routes. And we have evidence of the Harappan civilization doing that. And then again, in another verse, there occurs that the boats had 100 oars, Shataritra is the word, 100, I mean, large boats they were having. That was on the economic front. On the political side also, there is very good evidence about what was happening, what was the political structure of the time. There are two words mentioned in the Rig Veda, Sabha and Samiti. Sabha would be like a legislative body, and Samiti would be like a governing body. And the rulers were divided into certain stages. There were the words Samrat, Raja, and Rajak. And one might say that, no, this is all wrong. This is wrong statement in the Rig Veda. This is upheld by literal literature, the Brahmanas. In the Shatpat Brahman, it is very clearly said that by offering Rajasuya, he becomes a Raja. And by offering Bajpayee, he becomes a Samrat. I mean, there are different things. And again, it is very clearly specified. The office of Raja is lower and that of Samrat is higher. A Raja would like to become a Samrat, but the Samrat would not like to downgrade himself to become Raja. This is the statement in the Shatpat Brahman. So from all angles, it is very clear that they are economically very rich. They had fortified settlements. They were carrying on trade and commerce and had a very good integrated system of rulers. The names are mentioned. So it is the observation that the Harappans were highly advanced and the Vedic people were nomads, that is again wrong. Then about the horse. You see, occurrence of horse in the Harappan civilization has been a matter of debate because the evidence is not plentiful and it cannot be easily found. The reason is very simple. In the habitation area, you have got lots of bones of cattle and other animals. But the horse is not to that extent. Nevertheless, we have got reasonably good amount of evidence. At a place called Lothar in Gujarat, there is a terracotta figure of the horse. It is shown in this slide. Then at a place called Surkonda, again in Gujarat, there are bone remains which a world-renowned archaeologist has identified as those of horse. A specialist of bones, animal bones, Sandor Bocconi of Hungary has emphasized, and I quote, "The occurrence of the true horse, that is Equus Clavellus Lin, was evidenced by the enamel pattern of the upper and lower cheek and teeth, and by the size and form of the incisors and phalanges." There is absolutely very good evidence. Though the quantity of horse bones are not many for obvious reasons, in residential area you may not find them as much as you find. I have written a paper on that, why the scanty occurrence of this. So all the objections, this spoked wheel, again is interesting and important. You see, in our climate, which is hot and humid, the presence of wooden specimens is very difficult to find. The only one we have is the waterlogged area from of the Mauryan times of Pataliputra. Otherwise, there is no wooden chariot. But the terracotta models of the wheels very clearly show spokes. They are either painted, radiating from the hub, or they are in low relief. And here I present to you two photographs from Kalibangan and Banavali, which clearly show this. So all the objections fall to the ground. Now, I come to my last point. The Harappans, we have equated the Vedic people with the Harappans. Now, the question is, the question can be raised that are they indigenous? Now, the Harappan civilization, which was at its peak and maturity in the 3rd millennium BC, has been found to go back, and its roots go back to the 6th millennium BC. There are earlier stages from which it gradually developed. So we have so far traced it to the 6th millennium BC. Harappan civilization is that early, and maybe tomorrow we may find sites which are still earlier. These are all carbon 14 dated. Now, we have said that the Harappans and the Vedic people are two faces of the same coin. Now, if the Harappans are indigenous, going back to 6th millennium BC, naturally the Vedic people will not, because it's the same people, the Vedic people and the Harappans. We have always been talking about Aryan invasion, for which there is a short-term AIT, Aryan invasion theory. But there is another aspect of the whole thing. Did a section of the Vedic people go out of India? And it is not very well known, but we have ample evidence about it from two sources, literary and archaeological. The literary evidence comes from a book called Bodhayan's Shrut Sutra, in which there is a story that Urvasi and Ailpuravas had two sons called Ayu and Amavasu. And the story says, Ayu went eastwards. Tas ete krupa jala kashi videya. His progeny are the Kurus and Panchalas and Kashi and Vidyas. He went. And the other son, Amavasu, went westward via Gandhar, Parashu, Arat, modern Ararat, right up to Turkey. Now, here we are more concerned with the movement of Amavasu. That is a section of people represented by symbolically by. We have evidence of Aryan traces in Iran, further west in Turkey. We have very interesting evidence. There is a place called Boğazköy. Here clay tablets have been found, which record a treaty between the Hittite kings and the Mitannis. And in the treated treaties, you will be surprised to know that as witnesses to that treaty, four Vedic gods are mentioned: Indra, Varuna, Mitra, and Nasatis. Which means the treaty is dated to 1380 BCE, which means in the 2nd millennium BC, this took place. And there is more evidence which shows that in the 2nd millennium BC, the Vedic people had reached as far west as Turkey. Well, thank you very much. I have bothered you so much.